Welcome back to Into the Breach. Let's play on fair mode again. I have played the game a few times off camera, for my own amusement, of course, like I said. But let's pluck Henry Kwan from the time stream again, and try out on fair mode again. I feel like I want to get some more data on it, and if I'm gonna play it again, I might as well play it on camera, just so that I can, lend my own analysis and opinion to the whole thing. We're still kind of in the information gathering phase in that whole thing. I don't know if that's going to regularly be my play difficulty. I might go back and forth between hard and unfair mode. But we'll see. So the other squad I did really want to try out, like, as my dip my toe in the water for unfair mode. Steel Judica had that mass displacement going on, but Flame Behemoths is also all about that sort of thing. And Henry and the Flame Mech were made for one another. Oh, Henry just loves that flamethrower. So, it's November, it's cold, let's start some fires, huh? We're, gonna power ourselves up with this mech reactor, and, just see where things go. Alright, let's crank up that difficulty one more time, and head out there. So, hopefully this will go a little bit faster now that I don't need to just stand there and boggle at everything as it all happens. I'm prepared now. I know what to expect. So, let's take things out for a ride. Now, this plus one mech reactor, like I was remarking upon at the end of the previous videos here, I think if we're just getting started with unfair mode, this is one of the best bonuses we can bring along. Plus two mech HP, I could take it or leave it, but just being able to power a critical upgrade right from the beginning is going to help matters quite a lot. Now, since this is Henry, putting him on the swap mech, which already flies. I don't actually see that here, but it would have been in the preview screen, and you could see that here, so. The two best starting upgrades for this squad are this one, and Henry's not so useful on this one, so we'll put him over here, and we'll take this one. And even if it wasn't Henry, probably I would prioritize this upgrade slightly more than the plus one range here. This is really useful, don't get me wrong. I've gone on at length about flexibility of enemy repositioning, and this is absolutely super important when very few other weapons in the game have this kind of potential to move an enemy by two tiles. So, I will be trying to get this on as soon as I can, but I think the increased flexibility that this lends, and the extra damage potential, and the extra area denial, means that plus one range on the flamethrower is a little bit more important than plus one range on the teleporter. We'll see. You know, I might change my mind on that, but that's kind of how I think about things for now. So, let's see what the game has in store for us this time. We had some absolutely nightmarish islands on that previous run, which somehow I was able to deal with. But the game might be a little bit nicer this time. This looks alright. I mean, it's the explosive Scion Island, so probably still want to avoid this one, but let's not reflexively avoid it. Let's actually give it a fair look. Hornets and Scarabs are still great targets to be set on fire, particularly the weak ones. We could get some good friendly fire going on with the gastropods. Those are almost even better than Fireflies as far as that's concerned, because you can yank enemies out of position with them. Or perhaps into causing problems, but more often than not, out of causing problems, I would think. There's that boost Scion again, and actually the Alpha Blobber, or Blobber Leader, I should say. The Scorpion is really the only nasty part of this island. It's not bad. The Bouncer is usually not a problem. On this squad, they might be a little bit, like, just because of the 3 HP, but even then, this is a terrible island. The Flame Behemoths have a lot to be concerned about with the, Tumblebug leader. And Tumblebugs in general. I have learned through playing this offline, off camera. Yeah. That if a Tumblebug is not on fire, they don't want to spawn their rocks in fire. If I have that correct. I might be wrong about that, but I think it's a similar rule for them as it is with spiders and blobbers that lob those units. They don't want to put them into fire if they themselves are not on fire. But if they are on fire, then all bets are off. They'll put their stuff into fire and they'll make problems for you that way. And the concept of an exploding boulder being on fire is not one that appeals to me. So despite this enemy layout, the Leapers, Fireflies, and Maws not being so bad. I mean, everybody hates Maws, but aside from that, the rest of that island looks fine. Even the Regeneration Scion, not that much of a problem on this squad. I am concerned about that Tumblebug leader. Like, I want to be more powerful before I take that on. And then finally, this one just looks like a slog. I mean, the armor is not that much of a problem on this squad, thanks to the fire bypassing it, but it is really critical to be able to kill high-value targets like an Alpha Mosquito, for example. That extra 2 damage from the flamethrower would get reduced by armor, and that could make a big difference. That said, acid could help counteract that. So this is not a bad island per se, but it's definitely not my favorite. And the other one I was looking at was this one. Yeah, so I didn't like this one. I didn't like this one. It's these two. Would I prefer an Alpha Scorpion with 5 HP, or would I prefer no Webbers at all, but there's a Flying Smoker? Well, the good news, I can say, here's a squad-specific reason. I don't have as much to fear from the Mosquito as usual because I can replace their smoke with fire. So that will help give me some flexibility. They're not going to take away my bad tiles. And the boss is pretty reasonable here. In fact, it'll make more fire on the field. So yeah, okay, let's try this one out. I don't usually go to Armor Scion Island first, but I think this is a squad that can get away with that a lot more than the others. Okay, well, there's the disposal unit. Is there any reason why I would not want to go there immediately? No. Alright, disposal unit, help me out. So here's something fancy I can do. Once again, like, I'm taking a look at these back row, back rank units. Here's a Mosquito that has only one valid attack target, so if I put one of my mechs right here, it's useless. Like, it cannot do anything this turn. There's going to be a bit of a mishmash, like a crowding going on here, but there are 3 melee units here, so they're all probably going to bunch up around here or so. So probably what's going to happen... Let me take a look at the order here. Actually, you go first, but... Probably what's going to happen is, like, you two are going to go here, and then you're probably going to shoot down that way. Like, all 3 of these should be covered by these 3 enemies, so actually number 5's not going to have much to do either. So I should have fair odds of getting a solid shot with the acid launcher, like, especially with your guys' help. And this should just be a piece of cake. Like, I'm not seeing any problems here. Of course, because it's a disposal mission. But that's some good practice. Let's think about that kind of approach for the harder missions. Okay. Alright, well, I can already see some good stuff I could do. Here's one of the best features about the Vulcan artillery. It has building immunity built in. So, unlike the Artemis artillery from the Riftwalkers, where you have to pay for building immunity, you start with that, since this doesn't do any physical damage and it's okay to light a city on fire. So you can just do this. This is a legal move. And later on, when you get the +2 damage, then you're not allowed to do that anymore. But by that point, you want to start hitting enemies directly rather than doing this kind of shot. So, I think this shot would be pretty good. Like, if we do that, then we could take this shot and kill 3 high HP enemies on 1 action. So, I mean, really 2 actions, but that would be pretty good. Then you would be free to go up here and light you on fire. That would be great. You wouldn't really have much to do, but you could do something, I guess. And actually, the bouncer is kind of taking care of this problem for me a little bit, too. So the swap mech actually doesn't have anything to do. Well, okay, here we go. The swap mech can also make this happen, so I don't have to take this shot. I can do this, and that will work just as well. That means that we actually have an even better option. Yes. Yeah, don't worry, we'll fix that. Yeah, so I'd like to light you on fire. The reason why I'm doing it this way is that, I guess we could do this. Here's a 2 HP unit, it's on fire, I don't have to worry about it next turn. Yeah, that's actually the long and short of it. So there, not just 3-for-1, 4-for-1. Okay, seems like a good first turn to me. When it comes to gentle introductions to the game, just getting a nice, easy start to start things out with, you really can't go wrong with this thing. In fact, this is actually one of the super nice layouts. Like, I only need to spend 2 turns on these mountains, but I have a lot of flexibility in how I want to do it. So, how much advantage can we take from this? Well, we just want to get as much XP as possible, so we probably just want all these enemies to spawn, right? And then Henry's already maxed out, so we don't need to give him experience, so I don't know. All things being equal, probably slightly better to put fire on these tiles than acid, because the only damage we have on this squad that acid would actually double is flamethrower damage. So given that, like, fire is going to be better for us then. So I'm not going to try and get acid on a whole bunch of tiles. I'm just going to probably do this, like, keep these mountains here. Mosquitoes are the only flying units we have, so... Oh, and also, by the way, the acid launcher is smoke immune, just so that we don't, have a problem here. I think they had to patch that one out. So yeah, fire here. Also... I think they changed this at some point. I think you were not originally able to shoot through mountains in pre-AE, but now you can, so that's certainly nice. That gives you parity with the Prime Spear. Yeah, that weapon. And is it worth giving up one of your HP to kill you faster? Like, kill you this turn? Probably. Yeah, that seems alright. And there's no webbers on this island, so I don't have to worry about my meteor mech getting webbed. I do have to worry about it getting smoked, but that's not actually that serious of a concern. So, yeah, you want to put fire here, and then you'll just kill this off faster. I could just let it be. I could just let it remain here to help suppress spawns, but this is the disposal unit mission. I don't have to worry about that. Okay, actually, given that this pushes this tile, there's one slight improvement I can make here. Still doing this. You're going to go here first, and you're actually going to back up a little bit, because I think it's more likely you'll go back here than up here. So we do that first, we create the bump, and you still have an action so you can repair. And now you're at 2 HP. And that is slightly better than other ways I had of accomplishing the same thing. Like a bump on you, a bump on you. We saved 1 HP doing it this way. As promised, here's 2 enemies already on fire. So we've got plenty of good options now. I don't think we've got anything to worry about. This is a decent turn for disposal unit again. You are really the only problem, but we can fix that. Yeah, that's not hard to fix. Thank you, flexible artillery. So Henry can go do his thing, just walk right through that. Seems solid. We're blocking a spawn, but that's alright. Alright, you and me, disposal unit. We make a good team. Now, I would like to... I guess if I do a bump between you two, that would be good. That's how I can make Swap Mech contribute here. So something like this would work. Also, I have the disposal unit, so, you know, I could just do this, too. But there is no need for subtlety on this map. And as promised, there goes the smoke. Everything is good. Alright, you get out of here too, smoke. You guys will just have to activate the fans to deal with the smoke on your tile. I don't want to set the acid launcher on fire. Okay, job well done, as expected. A little bit of mechanical complexity there, but, like, you saw how little I had to really deal with there. So, really just trying to optimize that one beyond what was really necessary, but what else is new? This might be a bit more of a problem. 7 enemies on the field. Wow. I mean, the math all lines up. The base number is 5. This mission adds 1 more for 6. And it's a high threat mission, which means that you just start with 7. So, okay. I might not go that way. I don't think a missile barrage is going to be enough to clean this up. This is a bit of a slow burn squad. It's all about maintaining control on the first turn and then kind of leveraging that area denial and light hitting enemies that are already on fire for massive damage. So I'm on the lookout for weapons that will improve our first turns, of course. But then I'm always on the lookout for that stuff. This should be pretty good, though. Conveyor belts should give me a good advantage on the first turn. This actually looks like a new layout. Like, I'm not sure if I recognize either the city layout or, like, the conveyor belts on this, but it's I like the aesthetics of this. It's nice. So, yeah, conveyor belts will be very, very polite as far as neutralizing the bouncers for free, almost. So it's just going to be a matter of catching up to these guys, really. So just deploy like that's what I want to do, then. Put my longest range things. Yeah, you're fairly safe up here, and it's probably a good thing if, like, I lure this into attacking here. That's probably just good for me. So, yeah, this seems reasonable. You might get body blocked a little bit by the Scion coming in, but you're Henry. You don't care about being body blocked. Okay, fairly reasonable. You are going to become a problem, and you are a problem, so. Yeah, there's still, like, 3 attacks here I do have to care about, but thankfully it's only 3. Like, that is such a nice thing for unfair mode. Only 3 attacks to have to deal with. What a luxury. So what's the most efficient course of actions we can take here? I'd like to get some damage on you ahead of time so I can kill you easier. You, maybe not so much. You, I guess I'm going to plan on dunking in here at some point. That is maybe the argument for getting the plus one range on this a little bit sooner, is making it nice and convenient to teleport enemies into the water or into interference patterns. And that can happen through buildings. So that is certainly good. But can we... what can we do with our weapon now? Like, now that we have it. This does 2 damage, effectively. So if we get another damage on you via, say, a bump, then we're in good shape. What shots can you take? Actually, not that many. Like, I'd certainly want you to be able to hit this tile. That's kind of one of the reasons why I put you up here in the first place. But you actually can't do that as well. Like, this shot's not so good. You're bumping into you. You can't stand here. While this is tempting, going here and teleporting you this way, you're just going to move out of the way. So that doesn't really accomplish a whole lot. You're too far away to flamethrower this away. So it is going to have to be one of you two that deals with this. This is easy to block. This is really the problem. So it's probably going to be you who deals with this. You can actually deal with this pretty easily. Like, here's a 2-for-1. Yeah, you were standing in the water. That's right. So... you could take this shot, kill that, block that. That's pretty good. That's pretty effective. In fact, since you go first, what would then happen is... no, actually, that's not good enough. Hold on. This will go first, so you'll get dragged out of the way, and then you're not blocking this anymore. Okay. But we could fix that like so. So that's pretty effective. That lights one enemy on fire, shoves another one into acid, gets rid of this problem. That's pretty good. And it also blocks this tile, so enemies won't want to go here anymore. So it kind of introduces a bit of a bottleneck around this spot, for example. Then you would be free to just deal with you, I guess. So what would that look like? That looks like this. So both you and you will be going that way. So you'll get hit for 1, but you're Henry. You have 5 HP, so I don't even have to be worried about that. So it's not like you're down to 2 HP. You're down to 4 HP. That's not a problem. This is a little bit awkward, but I think it's worth it, because this is such a nicer shot than anything else I saw with this thing, so I think it's still worth it. Hold on. You have 4 movements, so you could go down here and you could be responsible for that. Does that give me any real benefit? It means that you could go up here and take this shot. Then you would be responsible for getting you off the building. And what would that look like? You are a little bit cramped up here. I don't think you can do it. Yeah, because this is a... oh no, that's a solid tile. So you could move out of the way. And you could go here and you could do this. But that would be bad. Right? Yeah, that would be bad. That would shove you backwards, and then the conveyor belt would take you forwards. You'd be here, and you would hit the building. And I don't think this has any other shots that can move that, so that doesn't work. So you are not responsible for dealing with this part. I think my first plan was better. It was a good plan. I was looking out for alternatives that would have been even better, but I think this one is fine. I think this will set me up okay for next turn. It's not brilliant or anything, but it's alright. Well, given that I know this is solid, you are also allowed to do this. That means you won't be standing here to get hit for 1. You'll be on the back lines, but you won't get hurt. And we'll get 1 more tile of fire here. I don't think I necessarily actually care about that. I think I actually want you up front. That's where a Prime Mech should be. So, you go here and do this shot. Then you go here and do this shot. And then do I want this to be on this tile or this tile? Probably this tile. I don't think it actually matters, though. But, like, the question is, do I do this first or do I do this first? And I think it mostly doesn't matter. I don't think the distinction between here and here matters. I might prefer the bouncer not to be able to go to this tile, but actually, yeah, that's actually a good thing if it goes to this tile. I want it to go there. That just makes my life easier. So, yeah, we will do it in this order then. We will make that a potential option for the bouncer to take. Yeah. We'll let it be able to go here. There's no reason not to do this. So you'll go here, you'll get hit for one, that's fine. You're gonna go down here, safely, and you'll start burning. You're out of the way. So we still have four enemies, but we've definitely made some good progress here. Alright. Oh, also it goes backwards. Okay, so all that actually didn't matter. Okay, fair enough. This is why you gotta love bouncers. Too low enough movement that they can't really go anywhere threatening. I could just walk right out of the way of all that, and they're basically my toys to play with. So all I gotta do is just do as much damage as possible. You love it. Alright, well, I think this is the most valuable thing you can do. This is pretty good. That makes a lot of nice things happen. You're already doing exactly what I want you to do, so I would just get out of the way and then light you on fire, I guess. You're gonna get dragged over here, and that's fine. So actually, you're gonna do this one. And let the bouncer just recoil itself into the water. Yeah. Which means I don't need to bump it. The difference between one bump damage and one bouncer damage is immaterial. But I'd prefer you to be up here. And as a bonus, I've lit this tile on fire, so now nobody's attacking this city. From melee, that is. You will get hit by that and put back here, but I think I still prefer you being here to here. Let's just say I'm taking advantage of, Henry having +2 mech HP. Sure, we'll call that a tactical application of that. Hold on, who goes first? You do, so this attack down this way will happen first, then this one. Oh, and let's remember to do this. Okay, so looks fine. I mean, I could have made changes to this if I needed to. I could have put you down here. I think I probably could have engineered a way where... Yeah, like, the only reason you're standing here is because I wanted to take this specific shot. If I didn't care about that so much, I could have just put you here, and you would have taken zero damage. So in some hypothetical universe where you only have 3 HP, that's what I would have done. But in the universe where you have 5 HP, you get to do this one instead. Alright, as promised, the order of events makes everything work, and now we have nothing to do this turn. Well, not literally nothing, but you know what I mean. And this is a setup turn, which the Flame Behemoths really appreciate. Having a turn where you have nothing to do, we can just gain even more control over the board. In this specific case, yeah, the swap mech can make this do exactly what I want it to do. So you will kill the shell sign for me and then burn to death later. Perfect. And let's get to work. Let's let the Flame Behemoths do what the Flame Behemoths do. I'm going to put you up here so that you go here and you're not in the way. And standing up here is fine, so sure. There we go. Lovely fire. We've barely started the game, and already we have lovely fires going. It's only going to get better from here, folks. This is why I love this squad so much. When you understand how it works, you get the fire to really burn properly. There's fire everywhere. Well, normally that would be a problem for you. I mean, A, you could just walk here, but Henry's a good anti-mosquito weapon. You can just walk out of the smoke cloud and go this way or this way or this way if you want to. How much of this do I actually need to care about? You're not doing anything worrisome. You're not doing anything worrisome. Neither are you. It's you and you. That's all I need to deal with. Now, I do have to actually get a little bit clever here. I do have to actually do something about this because you're in line here and I don't really have anybody super well suited for blocking this. All of my potential blocking VEC units are either on fire or, like, way out of the way. So, that said, I don't think I need to get super fancy here either. This is a pretty good shot. How much damage do I need to deal to you so that you're not a problem? I think it's one bump and two flamethrower damage. So something like this, and then this would be good. And then we're just not killing you, I guess. And I think that's fine. Yep. So, you're dead, this is going to miss, and that's going to miss. And conveyor belts are not causing me any problems. It's easy to forget. You gotta double check all these things. But if you do, very, very helpful. So that's the power of a good conveyor belts map layout there. There are some bad ones. There are definitely some where the conveyor belts are more of a hassle than a help, but that's what happens when they're a help. That's decent. I might go for that. We're still probably skipping this. Nobody's leveled up. You're getting close, but we can... You'll probably get there. Yeah, fire just spreading out the experience just makes things nice and easy as far as that's concerned. This is a decent map for Flame Behemoths. We're gonna have to be very efficient killing enemies in order to get this one. So it's probably one of these two. Which would I prefer to do first? Kind of a cramped map. But I do get an ally unit. It's not an amazing one, but it is one. Or one where I don't have any allies and it's cramped in the back. But I think everybody has pretty low movement here. Like, we've got the mosquitoes, but they don't have such high movement. All of these are in the back, which I really appreciate. Like, none of them are on the third row. That's usually just really good for me. So, yeah, a whole bunch of melee enemies. We've got a moat. Even if we have flyers over the moat, we can probably set them on fire. The worst thing that could happen on this map is, like, an alpha mosquito goes, like, right here. I can't set it on fire for whatever reason, and then it just immediately buries itself in my back line. But I think even then, I can deal with that. So I think this map's a little bit more friendlier than this one. I think I want to do this one first. Wow, the game is being very kind. So, great. Thanks to the CEO's foresight. We've got a nice moat for the melee enemies. We should clean this up, no problem at all. I was worried about there being, say, I don't know, 5 mosquitoes. It could have happened. It wasn't likely to happen, but it could have happened. I don't know where I want to put you, and... I don't know, I guess you'll go up here just so that maybe you can teleport the Alpha Bouncer into... Well, the Alpha Bouncer is even going to be attacking. None of these guys are going to be attacking. This is going to be like shooting fish in a barrel. So you see what I mean. Difficulty in this game can be very RNG influenced. You can have an absolutely nightmarish Island 1, or you can have an Island 1 where you just really are not having any problems at all. Okay, so we can't block, like, this spawns all the way out here. I'm not blocking that one. But we're going to kill enough enemies that we should have good opportunities to kill them on later turns. Which is exactly what is going to happen here. We've got a frontline mech right here. We've cleaned up the enemies enough. You're probably not going to be a problem next turn. Like, you're either going to go here or here, and I can deal with either of those fine. I say that, but, like, this tile being occupied will actually make this a hassle, so I'm glad I have at least one potential distraction for you, but even then, like, we can deal with this. You have three movement. Well, first comes to worst, you can get out of the way and you can flamethrower through this building, so that's an action available to us. We'll try and see if we can pick up the pod, but actually, yeah, just getting fire on this tile, that specific problem won't happen again. So, yeah, I don't think we have anything to worry about here. In fact, you actually have enough movement that you could even go up here and take the pod and swap it out of the way and kind of keep it on the back lines here. If we can finagle some other way to block spawns. Which could happen. So, yeah, I think this turn's fine. Another bouncer. Damn, you shouldn't have. What am I going to do? I thought unfair mode was supposed to be hard, folks. Oh boy, the game is absolutely going to make me regret saying that. So, obviously we're doing fine here. Like, this is happening without me even needing to say anything. That's just happening. That's burning to death. So all we need to do really is block this spawn. And maybe light it on fire for feeling especially frisky. You don't have much to do yet, so I think all you're really gonna do is go down here and just light this whole thing on fire. Just keep you completely useless. So, not a direct move, but certainly a situation improvement move for the future. Bouncers aren't going that way. And then, yeah, there's just nothing to do here. Hold on. Do this in the right order. I want to light this on fire, of course, but I also don't want to push whoever's here away. So, do this first. Yeah, do this first. Now you go over here. Bouncer recoil will put you on this tile. Glorious. Very swingy difficulty. But look at that control. Like, you don't have anything better to do than just attack me here. And that's exactly the wrong spot for you to attack me from, too. By the way. So, yeah, like, our only obligation is to block one spawn. I think we can manage that. Let's just put you here. I think that makes sense. You're already drowning. So that's our spawn objective taken care of. Nobody is going to be blocking any other spawns, which could be an issue. So let's see if I can create some distractions, maybe. Or maybe I just want to lay down some protective fire in the back ranks. Prepare myself for the, pair of alpha mosquitoes that are coming out of here. Yeah, like, honestly, like, is this even such a bad move? Like, now what are the... If I do that, what are the alpha mosquitoes going to do? One could go here. These could go up here. I can deal with them then. Like, just making it completely impossible for them to ever go back here would be pretty good. The other thing I could do is, like, body block some of those squares myself. Yeah, so pretending that these are the mosquitoes. Like, those are the only things I'm worried about. That's it. Even if these are, like, a firing squad of, snails, I could still deal with those, too. So, like, this is a pretty good move, and then just maybe lighting this on fire. Like, it's kind of a toss-up between lighting this on fire directly or lighting this on fire. Probably just lighting this on fire would be fine. Like, just keeping these squares clear so that there isn't a log jam back here is probably enough. And then lighting... hold on, that's... Okay, so I can't hit this, because that would push this over here, and then it would be a problem. Yeah, then you would get crunched into that, and that's no good. So we just simply don't light that on fire, we light one of these other two things on fire. And, I'm more concerned about this. So, light the frontliner units on fire. The back, you know, whoever this is, like, I almost don't care whatever this is. It could be a gastropod. Or it could be, like, a mosquito flying up here. And that's about it. So yeah, that enemy's dead. We only have three enemies to deal with, and I have optimized my handling of them as best I can. Also, this is still a distraction, by the way. Like, the enemies are not obligated to attack the swap mech, but they're allowed to, and if they do, it certainly makes my life easier. Like, no doubt about that. So, yeah, there's just a lot of good things happening here. Can I kill everything this turn? Like, I want so badly to be able to do this. But can I then handle that? I mean, you could just stand there and block it. That would be fine. How far over can you go? Not far enough. Yeah, like, we're definitely gonna need to get you some movement upgrades eventually. Yeah, like, we're just optimizing XP at this point, so this is a good enough move. This is a good enough move. We could have engineered a kill on you, and we have nothing else to do with our reset turn, so I guess we might as well. Once again, we are going to bump something into the swap mech. It keeps happening, but it's effective. It works for a reason. And, we're gonna put Henry's extra HP to use. That's the use of, plus one, or plus two mech HP, is, sometimes you just want to do that. Yeah. You're gonna burn to death first. Okay, so that's fine. We got two more XP squeezed out of all that. Alright, well, as expected, a positional manipulation squad is great when the enemies just kind of stand there and let you manipulate their positions. Oh, hey, Camilla. I don't know if we're necessarily going to get a ton of use out of you on this run, but we'll see. It could happen. And meanwhile, that is an excellent skill for a generic pilot to have, so good job. Everyone loves Dylan Patel. You're the most likely to be on the front lines, but it's the most annoying if you get webbed, so... You're probably going here, and honestly... Given that we're planning on selling you off, you're the one I actually want to give more XP to. Not that Masochist is really going to matter on a 2-health mech, but we've seen how, sometimes, we bump something into this mech and then this activates, so there's a chance. So, plus one move on you is pretty good. Plus one range on you is excellent. I think I care about this a little bit more. We can deal with the low movement as long as we're very careful with our deployment and very careful in particular with where we put you, but Henry will certainly help make up for that. So this seems pretty good. Let's just make our weapons more powerful. Stands to reason. Kill six or fewer enemies with the Flame Behemoths. Well, it's also fewer reps, so like, we want the rep, right? Yeah, of course we want the rep. I'm gonna go out on a limb and say that we're not equipped to handle this one. Not even with Camilla. I think maybe another squad can handle this. Maybe someday I'll have to try out the Blitzkrieg on fair difficulty. This might just be the perfect map for that kind of thing. Hit everybody with the lightning whip and also missile barrage them. Maybe. But let's try this one out. This is probably the most, like I had advantages on all of these other maps. This is going to be the most straightforward of a brawl. And even then, like, I have an advantage here, too. Like, I have not had a single map where, like, the deck was further stacked against me. This could get a little dicey, though. A little. These frontliner mosquitoes are going to be the real wild cards here, but I really don't have a good choice other than to just try and block the worst spots they could go to and then just see what happens. I really don't want one to go here. Because, like, then it's awkward. Like, you would want to push it away and it would go here, and that's still a problem. So I definitely don't want two mosquitoes to line up here. I definitely don't want the alpha to be right here. I think it's slightly more important to block this than this. Because if a mosquito goes here, Henry can walk through it and push it back the other way. And if it goes back here, then I can just simply push it back here. Meanwhile, I guess the Meteor Mech might handle these pairs of bouncers. Maybe if I'm real lucky, this bouncer will attack the acid tank. We'll see. So, I think we've got fair odds that we can either make somebody whiff an attack, or we can get a 2-for-1, or something along those lines. So, I think this is about as good a deployment as we're going to get. And this is fairly good flexibility for the Meteor Mech. Look, there's no particular reason why I would want it to go here. Would there be? No, like, these are too high HP for hitting them directly to be that good yet. So, you just being able to go here is good, and you're never going down here. So maybe you can stand here and attack this tile, if that makes sense. So being able to reach here will help. Okay. Maybe there's some marginal improvement to be made to that deployment. Also, yeah, there's the fact that these guys could attack from up here, which I didn't really acknowledge, but certainly being up front will help deal with that too. And we got lucky. Saturation of melee targets. Again, you didn't have anything to do. Great. So, this is probably the most effective thing you can do. I think that makes sense. Who would I I don't have a good way of both lighting you on fire and moving you is the slight issue here. So, given that, like, probably this makes sense. At least get more bump damage on you guys first. And then just teleport you backwards, like, probably right here. Yeah, that seems reasonable. So make this bump happen first. Now, move you. Then who do I want to put acid on? Probably you. Because you'll die eventually. You'll die eventually. You, I might theoretically want to set on fire at a later date. And then burn you. So I think acid will do more good on you. Yeah, like, I am probably killing you before the mission is done, so I don't think I have to be in a hurry to put acid on you so that I stay on pace. I think it's better to get a chance to kill you. Yeah. So, that does mean you're a little bit pinched in, but honestly, you are doing a fine job as a distraction right here anyway. So, you're already dead. We have four enemies again, but at least we have one that's already on fire and one that's acided, so we're slightly better off than we were before. Great. Yeah, also I got a protective wall of fire. That's amazing. Can we leverage that for next time? We'll see. It will depend. So, I guess we want to light you on fire and push you. Because, like I said before, like, you're in the bad spot, so now I have to kind of move you away without lighting you on fire. Merely moving you is okay. So something like, you go back here and just teleport this. Also, wait a minute, you do have two teleport. Yeah, I did get that already, so that does matter. That means I could teleport you out of the way, for example. So, then I could do something like this, and then you go here and do that, and that's pretty good. Yeah, that's reasonable. Then you're on hand to go deal with these guys coming in. Then we let the acid tank out, and it could do something more productive than just hitting this, which is a decent move, but it could, say, body block this bouncer. Yeah, now we're talking. This is what just one of the great things about having allied units is you can just make such great use of them. Even if they're weak, even if they don't do a whole lot, they do enough. Yeah, so now, like, the bouncer will still it'll still wind up going here, but that's a good spot for it. Yeah, so there'll be contention for this square, I guess you could say. These are good tiles to light on fire. You know, it's just a pity that I can't do this move. That would be the most efficient thing. Like, if, in some perfect universe, I would like this to go here and light this on fire and push it away, and then you would take care of this by not pushing it, but... Oh well, at least we get the acided enemy on fire. So, maybe next turn you'll kill this off. So far so good. Like, I know we haven't killed any acided enemies yet, but we're on track to. I think we can make that happen. Although, one of the things that Flame Behemoths does struggle with sometimes is killing an enemy on the final turn. Okay, that's a little yucky, but I can still probably deal with that. Simply moving you aside will work. So maybe that's Swap Mech's job. On the other hand, you're in an awkward spot. So, like, once again, like, you're in a bad spot for this kind of thing. Although, if I can kill you, or move you away by some means, then I could get you in there, but how would that work? I don't want to put you here, because then you would be standing, like, if I took this shot, then you would be, go here, and it would attack this tile. It's only for three, though. Yeah, you could survive that. Once again, that plus two mech HP that I came in with, you wouldn't normally think that would be a good thing to take to a new timeline. Like, that's not an attractive skill. But every now and then, like, you can actually make use of it. So we could do that. You would go here and survive and take that shot. Then you would probably go here and teleport that. I think that makes sense. You wouldn't block that spawn, but you'd kill yourself off. That's convenient. Then you would maybe go here and acid that. Yeah, just as some fodder to kill off and get the acid counter. So you would be on the route to destruction. You would be on the route to destruction. You would be acided. And I could get that burn plus push that I was looking for. That seems pretty good. I do like that. Plus we get rid of smoke on this tile, which is a good tile to be able to attack from. So it's a lot of HP to be spending, certainly. Like, three is a lot. But we can take it. So, there were plenty of ways to solve this turn in a way that would satisfactorily solve just this one turn, but I'm setting myself up well for the next turn. Hey, look, a distraction. Okay, so this is exactly what I was talking about. So we need to kill you. A single bump will take care of that. We need to kill you. And we also need to kill whatever this marks with acid. So we need to mark something with acid, and then deal with, one, two attacks. I think this all lines up. Honestly, I'm a little bit concerned about you. You're maybe the wild card here. I'm not sure how we kill you off. Well, I think we do it via a, via lighting you on fire and bumping you into something. Yeah. So, any bump takes care of you. So, for example, this would be perfectly fine. Thankfully, I don't have to worry about you at all. You're just something useful that I can use as a tool. Can't quite make you go all the way down here. That would be very useful if you could. Then I could actually take this shot and bump you into this, and then, like, there's the bump, and I can light you on fire. Also, somebody does need to deal with you. If we're doing a perfect run, but I think I can manage that. Also, hold on. You do recoil. Can I make use of that? Not really. Like, I can't make you attack you, can I? Not without spending two actions to do it, and that's probably not actually worth it. So I guess let's take stock. Like, let's reduce this to basic principles. Who can kill which of these acided units? You can kill this, and you can kill this. The swap mech cannot. I can't set up friendly fire to with the teleport. Like, this is going all the way out here. Teleporting you up here doesn't help unless, like, somehow I get rid of this and I move this down here or something, and I don't think any of that's happening. So one of you two must kill this one. Who can kill this unit? The only enemy attack I've identified that's likely to do it is you, so otherwise it has to be fire and a bump. Yeah, that's the only way we're killing a 2 HP enemy that is not yet on fire. Then we are free to choose, like, in this scenario, I must kill either this enemy or this enemy. You're actually the more likely one to kill, precisely because you're standing next to acid already. I am fairly sure that you have to put the acid on this first and then dunk it. I don't think pushing it into an acid pool like that counts, but I'm not sure. I am not positive about that. We have a reset turn, so let's test that real quick. If that counts, that will change the equation. It does not. Okay. Now we know. Is there any other information we would like to gather before we stop? Like, solving this mission is no problem at all. Like, there, we're done. Okay, that does not result in actually killing this, but it's close. So that would result in failing the objective and, losing out on probably one star. Like, we're halfway done, so probably we would get one star for this if I had to guess. So that's not what's that question here. What's that question here is trying to kill immediately on this turn. And that is something that we do struggle with right out of the gate. This is an illustration of that thing I was just talking about. So one person kills you, one person moves you. Yeah, moving you. And then one person needs to deal with you. And somebody needs to deal with you in one action. Like, I'll tell you, this is the single move I can think of that kills this, but we certainly have a problem here. Like, your job is not done. If it already were, then that would be great, but, like, I would actually be willing to sacrifice the acid tank. Much as I usually like to make a big deal about saving this pilot, the game does not actually care whether this person lives or dies. I hate to admit it, but it's true. So if there's a perfect solution to all of this, like, I would actually sacrifice your life in order to deal with all this. However, I don't think this is even the right move, because, you need to go somewhere else to hit this or this first. And there's no other convenient acid pools around, either. Like, killing you is not going to put acid in a good spot. Killing you would put acid down on the ground, but I wouldn't be able to teleport an enemy into it, for example. It wouldn't do enough. So, you will not be the backboard to this move. So, for example, you do one damage. So, if I, say, shoved you here and then did that, then you would kill the Scion for me. But as we just saw, lighting you on fire once, and then, Hold on. I am seeing something here. If I teleported you here, no, you only have 3 move. Darn. I was going to say you could teleport here, and then I could have moved Henry here and shot through both of them. And that would have done 1 damage to you, and that wouldn't have been enough. Oh, hold on. Yeah, because the armor Scion is still alive. Yeah, so the flamethrower would do 1 damage to you. So you would take 1 damage, be on fire, and then you would have to bump into something to die. Unless I put acid on you first, then lighting you on fire kills you. So that's one way in which, yeah, like, that makes sense. Like, I could even, do this, like, acid you and then, light you on fire, and that certainly kills you. Like, that's not a problem. So I could acid you... Oh, hold on. So here's another thought. Like, I'm thinking of 2-for-1s. Like, I think I need a 2-for-1 in order to make this all work. If I put acid on you, and then take this shot, that both deals with you to put you over there, and it puts an acided enemy into the water, and that will count. So that's your turn and your turn, and then that leaves you and you to deal with this. The problem is that you can deal with that. As we discussed earlier, you can't deal with that, sadly. You're not Harold and you're not Kazakhplith Killik, so you can't deal with this situation. I would like to... So here's a way in which you could deal with this. If you teleport here, you will light this on fire, and then we can do a 3-for-1 shot, and that way we will get a bump and a fire on you that way. And I think that works. So let's review. Order of events here. You go either here or here. It doesn't look like it matters. Here. Put acid on this. You go here. Teleport here and act as a backstop to cause a bump on this thing. So you do a teleport. We do this amazingly good move. Thank you, Vulcan Artillery. Which puts the acid enemy in here. Does this bump. So both of these are dead. That gets us up to 3 out of 4 killed. And you would go here first, and you would do this. I think that all works. Wow. We're really squeezing every inch of potential out of this squad, but my goodness, does it certainly have that potential. That potential is there for me to find. This squad has that potential. So you're dead, and you're the fourth enemy. And you're just harmlessly doing this. Perfect. That's what I like to see. Three actions at once with that shot. Alright, well, I think we're ready. Let's fight the boss, eh? With a pretty solid retinue there, and two fronts for me to defend. And maybe a third if that's a mosquito and goes all the way up here or something. But that's unfair mode for you. Like, what else are we going to do? Did anybody get promoted? No. I didn't manage to funnel experience to you. That's fine. You'll get there. In fact, you're going to get there in the middle of the battle, so I'll have to improvise from there. We do have the plus one range on the teleporter. Like, we're guaranteed to have that. Yeah, because we came in with the core, and we're guaranteed to have the time pod in one of those four missions. So by the time we get to the boss, this is what this is going to look like. I think this might be our secret weapon against this boss. Okay, where's it gonna go? It could just immediately just stand there and attack that way. If we get a mech here, it might attack that way. That's good. Certainly want that to happen. Where do I want to put everybody? You're backline mosquito, so your only option is to attack this building. You have a second option. You could go here. So there's, like, some minor target saturation going on here, like... This is probably going to get clumped up. This is probably a pretty good spot to put you. And then, like, right here. So this way, you can go down here and shoot here if you really have to. If you absolutely have to, you can take that shot. And I probably slightly prefer you to be back here as opposed to up here. If you're up here, you might get body blocked and that can get awkward for you. But you've got good range of motion up here. Plus, you can still go to this here. So this is a good spot for you. Three movement. That's not great, but it's enough for an artillery when you put it here. I'm usually a big fan of deploying these things up front, but I think this gives you maximum flexibility. Flexibility is what I'm looking for an artillery deployment. And then you're up here, and you can cause all manner of chaos, and then you're down here, and you can start putting fire here. I think I care more about there being fire on these tiles than on these tiles, which are more easily bypassed. I want this bottleneck, this area, to be full of fire. Alright, I think that's about as good as it gets. We'll just see what happens after that. Okay, well... Boss is doing my job for me, just laying down some nice fire. In fact... Huh. So I guess the bouncer must have noticed that the gastropod leader was tagging this tile with fire, and that was enough to make it not want to go over here. Like, I think normally these things only care about, like, targeted damage, but probably under the same principle, like... Enemies don't want to walk in front of a firefly shot and stand on any of those tiles it's passing over. Probably it doesn't want to go here. Like, it's tagged as being affected by the boss. So that's probably what's going on. Anyway, we are actually probably going to want to get rid of the shell scion. We've been kind of ignoring it for a while, but we are at the point where it might actually matter. So, just plain old taking this shot and then just teleporting again sounds pretty good. Yeah, and then, of course we're doing this. Like, yeah, that just goes without saying. We're just doing that. I'm a little bit worried about next turn, but I think just the... Like, I don't think this even has anything to do, is the thing. I guess we'll make it Q an attack. Because I probably do care about that a little bit more. So I guess it's just really a question of where do I put the mosquito. Like, the swap mech is going to end up on this tile. So I think I want the mosquito to be as far out of the way as possible. Which would be here. Okay, like, given this and given that, like, I definitely want to put you on fire. You're the lowest health. That's basically how this turn had to go. There were some variations I could have taken on that turn, but they all would have looked more or less like this. And good thing we've got fire immunity. Don't have to care about that. The boss has taken the bait. Yeah, this is just a great turn for me. I just do not have to care about a lot of these things. You are recoiling backwards, so tell you what, you're actually going over here now. In fact, you're killing the Scion for me, too. I didn't even realize that, but you know what? That's just great, too. There's just nothing else to say about this. It's just a lot of great things are happening. Do I want to light you on fire, or do I want to kill you? Like, that's the amazing thing, is, like, you're just not doing anything. And neither are you, really. Honestly, keeping... Like, if I light you on fire, that means you might go down here and actually attack. So, funnily enough, I think I actually don't want to light you on fire. If I don't light you on fire, your only options... I'm being serious here. Your only options are to go here and attack this. Yeah, because I think it just will not go at any of these other spots. There is maybe an argument for figuring out if I can kill this turn. Like, the option I was considering was this. Just killing this off, lighting this on fire. But if I do this attack, it actually kills the Armor Scion on my turn, which means I get one more damage on the boss. And I think that's meaningful. Like, again, there's target saturation here. There are going to be two enemies, and one of them will go here, and the other one will have nothing to do. Yeah. Like, that's the long and short of it. So, I have the freedom to take this move. And there. The boss is that much more deader. In fact, because of that, it's dead next turn. I don't care what it does next turn. It's 1 HP, and it'll be on fire. This is ridiculous. Like, compare and contrast with the island one I had in that other run. Now, the graphic makes this a little ambiguous, but this is on fire. Like, that is very much on fire. So, yeah, I don't have to do anything there. All I really need to do is just start lighting this stuff on fire. It'd kill you, I guess. Like, it'll be an act. You will actually be a problem if I let you. So I just won't let you. So, yeah. Yeah, like, you don't have anything to do. Like, you're not far enough forward to cross this. So, yeah, tell you what, you can go all the way up here. You're not going to get directly attacked. The only thing you could get attacked by is gastropods, and this is a great spot for you to be for gastropod attacks. You can just move out of the way. We can even start spawn blocking at this point, but I just don't need to. I just plain do not need to. And... I'm not even sure I want to light any of these on fire. It's crazy. With the Flame Behemoths, you want to be lighting these tiles on fire, but just look at how great my area denial is. It's just amazing. Let's just literally not give any enemies anything to do. Like, if this is a mosquito, the best it can do is go all the way out here, and attack my mechs. That's it. So for... Well, there's only one more turn left. Like... Well, also, I could light this tile on fire. Yeah, that's a good move for next turn. So you could stay in the center. Yeah, so that way, if there is a mosquito, it might get lured up here, which I don't want. I'm overthinking this. Like, I really do not need to be thinking this hard about this. There. So we're gonna go with the strategy of not lighting any of this stuff on fire, and we're gonna body block, stand as the body blocking guardians behind the fire, and just do what we do best. I think there are going to be four enemies here who are going to be absolutely stuffed by this. There might be one mosquito that might be a problem. And I think I can handle it. There goes the boss, by the way. It's already dead. Alright, well, as promised, there's the mosquitoes and the, bouncers and the gastropod, and it's just not a problem. Nothing that is happening here is a problem. At all. There is absolutely just not an issue whatsoever. Alright. Lovely fire, and an enemy set very, very susceptible to the fire. I think I picked the right island, folks. Okay, I mean, I don't... The thing is about this squad, you have the fire immunity already, so... We don't care about that. Immunity to acid's okay, I guess. It's not great. But it's okay. Well, there's Lily. No skills, and, a weapon I don't really care that much about. We've seen how useful having one more health can be sometimes. But it's still a pretty defensive skill. Do I care more about squeezing more potential out of Lily? Well, figuratively, you know what I mean. Or trying to squeeze more potential out of, honestly, a pretty core-hungry effect. Like, when you consider that a lot of weapons don't need a core to power, and this still needs a core, that's not a great deal. Like, 1 HP across 3 mechs is more raw HP than +2 HP on 1, but usually +2 HP on 1 is actually more meaningful. I think we might just take Lily. Like, this isn't a great bonus, but it's better than nothing. And I think I care more about movement than HP. Like, we already have one good HP flagship. We don't really need more. So, yeah, I think I care more about +3 move on the first turn than maybe +2 move on later turns if I can engineer it properly. And I think I still want Camilla here. Yeah, I think that makes sense. I think I care... I still... Like, maneuverable has been great on you. It's been giving me a lot of options. I don't think I actually took any of them, but I was happy to have them. And I'll certainly be happy to have them on future islands. Oh yeah, and also we have the popular hero, so actually life is just great. Also, this is the perfect weapon for Flame Behemoths. This is just one of the ones I'm always on the lookout for, and it's just amazingly solid. It solves all the problems that Flame Behemoths has. It's just great. So, I'm getting it. That means I'm not going to get four cores, but the Rocket Fist is just so good that it's worth missing out on that. And I could get rid of you and get boosters, and that seems pretty good too. So I'm gonna do it. Alright, thank you, popular hero. So we will move the flame shielding. Putting this over here makes sense. And since you already have access to that pattern of push, then we will give that pattern of push to you. Boosters, like if we didn't have the Rocket Fist, if this wasn't here, boosters would have been a good option for Flame Mech 2. I like that. Gives it, like, helps solve this problem. You can push from far off the board, and it's an alternate push pattern for this. Maybe later in the game I might swap weapons. I might put the boosters on this and then put the Rocket Fist on you. Just so that both of you have a damaging option and a finesse option. But I think for now, just like leaning into, you get, this is cheap. We're going to save one core this way. Now we can just murder our enemies. And I think I care more about getting even more range on you than I care about the rocket per se, I think. Although that is still really, really handy. Like, with this, I don't need this anymore. Like, now I have that. One more move on you wouldn't be too bad either. So, here's my choices. Plus one move on you. Plus one more range on you. I think I want the plus one more range. That enables lots of shenanigans. So yeah, we're going to be getting up to a lot of nonsense now. You're not going to have quite the flexibility I would like, but still, just the plain old solid killing power of this ought to be enough that I shouldn't miss this. I think I can be afford to be patient and wait on this one. We'll get it soon, but I think we can wait on it. Cool. This is a very powerful Flame Behemoth. And hopefully, we can keep it that way.